O Christ, you are the true light who guides all people. You shine the splendor of your radiant light on the eyes of the blind. Through your grace, open our minds and consciences to the light of your gospel. Accept the fragrance of our incense and our repentance, that we may raise glory and thanks to you forever.
So that those who do not
For the proclamation of the gospel of our Savior announcing life for our souls, we offer you this incense and ask for your mercy, O Lord. Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
From the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. Mark, who proclaim life to the world, let's listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls.
Remain silent, O listeners, for the Holy Gospel is about to be proclaimed to you. Listen and give glory and thanks to the Word of the living God.
The evangelist Mark writes, they came to Jericho, and as Jesus was leaving Jericho, and his disciples, and with a sizable crowd, Bartimaeus, a blind man, the son of Timaeus, sat by the roadside begging. On hearing that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and to say, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. And many rebuked him, telling him to be silent. But he kept calling out all the more, Son of David, have mercy on me. Jesus stopped and said, call him. So they called the blind man, saying to him, take courage, get up, for he is calling you. He threw aside his cloak and sprang up, and he came to Jesus. And Jesus said to him in reply, what do you want me to do for you? The blind man replied to him, Master, that I may see. Jesus told him, go your way. Your faith has made you whole. Immediately he received his sight and followed him on the way. This is the truth. Peace be with you. So coming on this Sunday in the Gospel of St. Mark, we come in a sense to like the apogee, the pinnacle of the notion of conversion, of what requires of us not only that we have faith, and that we also know that we need to be healed, this the phrase from the blind man, Rabboni, that I may see, but in saying it out loud, the acknowledgement of it. That's why the aspect of penitence, confession of our sins, all of this aspect is a path that we follow on the way to our Lord. But at the same time, the blind man is also, there's an intimacy here by the term which is used. In the lectionary, we have translated the word master. Master, in America especially, we think about slavery. Master is actually from the Latin word magister, which means teacher. But the term actually in the gospel is Rabboni. My teacher. There's an intimacy here which is not just rabbi, teacher, but Rabboni. And we're going to hear it again in a few weeks' time when Mary Magdalene finds our Lord in the garden on the day of the resurrection. She doesn't recognize him. She thinks he's the gardener, we're told in the gospel. I mean, she sees him, she's talking to him, but she doesn't see him. She doesn't recognize him. Until he says to her, Mary. And in hearing her name, now she sees, and she says, Rabboni, my master, my teacher, And she falls on her knees in front of him and then begins to grab him around the knees in this great joy. So there's an intimacy in both of these, and they echo one another. The blindness of this man outside of Jericho. And obviously, he's known to the community. We're given a personal name for this blind man. We don't usually receive names for the people that are healed. But this man obviously has a place in the community that's known, and his father is known. It's a strange gospel because translating in the Greek, they're translating directly from the Aramaic. Because Bartimaeus means son of Timaeus. And so to say Bartimaeus, who is the son of Timaeus, well, anybody would know that by his name in the first place. But he's someone who's known to the community. And of course, the gospel finishes by telling us that once he arrives at this point of recognizing and saying out loud, "Lord, that I may see," we're told he follows our Lord with this miracle. He follows him on the way. And the way is the terminology, if you read the Acts of the Apostles, the way is the term which is applied to the gospel and our Lord's teaching before the disciples begin to call themselves Christians in Antioch. The term is just the way. This is the path that's been shown to us by the Messiah. Now, in the Syriac Fathers, the church, the vision is of a robe of glory, this life of grace that we receive. And it's why in Genesis they interpret that, when Adam and Eve fall, when humanity falls by its sin of origin, we're told in the scriptures a very short line, and they saw that they were naked. The Syriac tradition, it really emphasizes that humanity was clothed in glory before that sin. And that the spiritual life, starting with baptism, which is why we garment and clothe in white, newly baptized, but that the notion of the spiritual life is us to work toward regaining this robe of glory and to return to paradise, to return to the garden as humanity was originally created in grace. So that's one vision that's going on here. And we see it in Bartimaeus when he's told, "Be of good cheer, courage. Yeah, I know we were telling you to shut up just a minute ago, but now he wants you to come over here." What we're told is he immediately throws off his cloak and jumps up and goes to see our Lord. Now, in the interpretations that are given then in this robe of glory, what Bartimaeus is throwing off quite quickly in response is the cloak of Jericho, the clothing of Jericho. And Jericho in the Gospels always represents worldliness, concerns only of things here below. Jericho, as I mentioned to you, was the resort town for Jerusalem. It's only about 13, 16 miles outside of Jerusalem, but it's an oasis, and it was a place to go. It was very nice, very pleasant. And so our Lord meets him outside of Jericho, outside of the worldliness, but he's clothed in Jericho's garb. And so when our Lord calls him, he throws off this garb in order to set himself on the way. He throws off his worldliness and his worldly concerns up until this point. Now mind you, that the worldliness is not something which negated his faith. He believed, but he was not yet perfect, and he certainly didn't see. He's blind. And his blindness reduces him to being a beggar. In the gestures that we make when we pray, when our hands are folded, the reason why we make this gesture is because our hands are empty. We put them together to indicate precisely the fact that they are empty. That's the original meaning of this gesture. And we know here that in the context of this gospel, what is also taking place is this is the last miracle in the Gospel of St. Mark before our Lord's Passion. This is the end of chapter 10 of St. Mark. Chapter 11 is going to begin. What immediately takes place after this is Palm Sunday, next week. But prior to it, our Lord gives the last and the final announcement, foretelling of his passion. He tells them, we're going up to Jerusalem now, just before this episode. So as they go past Jericho to Jerusalem, that's when they meet the blind beggar. But he tells them, we're going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man is going to be betrayed, imprisoned, spit upon, and put to death, crucified. But on the third day, he will rise again. The apostles don't hear this. In St. Luke, it's repeated three times. They don't understand what he says, they don't get what he's saying, and they don't understand. Three different ways he says, they're clueless, they don't get this. They have now been with our Lord for 3 years, seeing miracles, the multiplications of the loaves and fishes, listening to the teaching day in and day out. The progress of the spiritual life to return to the robe of glory and to return to paradise is lifelong. We never finish this path. So the Passion is announcing beforehand. It's going to begin with Palm Sunday, just after this episode, when they leave Jericho and arrive in Jerusalem. And in between, we have then this miracle of the blind beggar. And just before, we have another example of the apostles being blind. It's the episode where James and John come to our Lord. And they say, all right, you're going to establish this new kingdom. Make us number one and number two in it. Make us CFO and CEO, or at least put us on the board of trustees, make us part of it. And our Lord, of course, famously says to them, you don't know what you're asking for. They're 20-somethings. Of course they know what they're asking for. 20-somethings, oh, we always know. When we're young, we are immortal, and we have infused wisdom and knowledge. We know this. Everyone else is stupid. So these young men, of course everyone's young in this band. St. Peter might have been a bit older, but older meaning he's in his 30s. And when they come up and he says, you don't know what you're asking for, can you drink the chalice which is mine? And in the Old Testament, in the Psalms and the prophets, the notion of the chalice is that's your destiny. It's what God has given, poured out for you. Can you do this? Well, of course, these 20-somethings have no idea what that actually means. He's just told them, we are going to go be crucified and publicly humiliated in Jerusalem. Yeah, they answer, we can do this. And he tells them, the chalice you will partake of, but to give you positions at the board of trustees is not mine, my Father's to give. Then we're told they arrive at Jericho, and we have today's gospel. So we have apostles who have been with our Lord, God incarnate, day in and day out for 3 years, and they still don't see. This is the important thing that we know here. Bartimaeus believes. He knows our Lord is the Messiah, which is why when he hears in the crowd this commotion and they tell him it's Jesus of Nazareth, he knows this is the Messiah, and he believes, which is why when he calls on our Lord's name, he calls him Son of David. This is a messianic title. He believes that our Lord is the promised one. He has faith, but it's not perfect. There's always progress for us to make. We are not once saved, always saved people. The church has never had that thought. Baptism is the beginning of this pathway. It is not the end and the full conclusion. It only puts us on the way. And that's why when the people around our Lord having this concern, telling this man to be quiet, stop shouting, this is unseemly. In any way, you're a beggar. Who do you think you are to talk to the rabbi of Nazareth? We're told that he shouts out even more. This time he just drops our Lord's name and just calls out, Son of David, have mercy on me, reiterating this faith. But you'll notice that when the beggar is brought to him, and it's why it's important for us on this last week of Lent proper, initiating Hosanna week, leading up to Hosanna Sunday, that what our Lord does when the man arrives, our Lord sees that he's a beggar. Our Lord sees that he's blind. He's led over. But our Lord then says to him out loud, what is it that you want me to do for you? Well, most people in the crowd would have thought, isn't it obvious? He's blind. But our Lord makes Bartimaeus say this out loud. This is the connection with our notion of confession, of our repentance, of what we say out loud. Our Lord knows our sins. But he has the sacrament of penance because it is the moment, like Bartimaeus, for us to come and say, Rabboni, that I may see. Teacher, that I may be able to see. And the sacrament of penance works in the same way. Our Lord knows what we've done wrong. He knows what our wounds are. He knows what needs to be healed. But he makes us acknowledge that fact. And hence the institution of the mystery of penance. It is the reason why the very obviously blind man and the very obviously poor beggar is made to say out loud what he is actually looking for. Rabboni, that I may see. And remember the intimacy of calling him my teacher. Illuminate my mind. If you look at the prayers at the beginning of this Mass today, you see that it opens up. We ask for our hearts and our consciences, our minds to be opened to the light of the gospel. Penetrate us further. Garb us in the robe of glory. And on that last point of healing to leave you with, is that this year we're going to do the rite of the lamp that's on Thursday of Great and Passion Week. Oftentimes, in the recent years, you've done it at noon. But we're going to do it at 6 p.m. in the evening, the lighting of the lamp. And for those who have been there, you know, it's the kind of unusual bread dough with 7 candles stuck into it, and oil that is blessed. Part of the ceremony amongst the prayers is we are asking for healing. The rite of the lamp is a very ancient Syriac practice during this Passion Week. Because we open it up on Palm Sunday evening with coming into the harbor. We go through the masses Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. And on Wednesday evening, before we open up the third of the Triduum, the Great Thursday of the Divine Mysteries, Good Friday, Saturday of the Great Light, we open it by Wednesday evening with the rite of the lamp. And we step forward to be anointed with the blessed oil on our foreheads, just like extreme unction when we're dying. Because we are asking for that healing grace to renew our minds at the end of the great fast. And now, with having come into the harbor and been anointed by our Lord's grace, by the rite of the lamp, we now are well to enter with our Lord into Jerusalem for Thursday, Friday, and Saturday to receive his healing and to walk as Bartimaeus does along the way. Follow the way faithfully, we have to acknowledge that we need sight, and that is grounded on that faith in our Lord. May our faith be increased, our charity enlivened. May Bartimaeus himself intercede for us in these prayers, so that each one of us can stand before our Lord to say, Rabboni, my master, open my mind, open my conscience, that I may see. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We believe in one God,
consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men, to the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and we look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Peter on page 774. 774. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
O Father, God of peace and Lord of security, make us worthy to embrace one another with a sincere kiss in the spirit of your unending love, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever. The holy mysteries placed upon you. Peace to you, O minister of God.
Let each one of us give a greeting of peace to his neighbor with love and faith, which is pleasing to the Lord.
Amen.
Remember, O Lord, Lord, those who have asked us to pray for them, those who desire but one able to make an offering, and those who assist your holy church, be a shelter and a refuge for them, for you are the Savior of all. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the civil leaders in our country and throughout the world. Enlighten their consciences to bring security and peace to your people. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the Holy Virgin Mary, Mother of God, and the prophets, apostles, martyrs, and confessors, St. Joseph, St. Jude, St. Mary, St. Cyril, and all the saints. Assist us through their prayers and make us worthy of their reward. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the righteous fathers and teachers who have gone to their rest among the saints. Remember those who diligently carried your gospel throughout the whole world and confirmed your holy church in the true faith. Assist us through their prayers and strengthen us in your love. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, our parents, brothers and sisters, teachers and faithful departed here and everywhere who have gone to their rest. Forgive us and forgive them of all sins and offenses. To our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ, who is without sin, we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for their.
Power and glory are yours, now and forever.
overcome. But deliver us from every evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, with your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your head before the God of mercy, before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, who gives life to those who partake of him, and receive the blessing from him.
The Lord bless your worshippers who bow before you and implore you. Make them worthy of your mercy and forgive their sins, for you are almighty and rich in compassion. We raise glory and thanks to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility, and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth, to him and be glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiven blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins and for new life. O Lord our God, to you be glory forever.
Thank you.
about to drink. O Lover of all people, have mercy on us.
Have mercy on us, O Lord, O compassionate and merciful one. O Lover of all people, have mercy on us.
Thank you, O Father, for this gift that you have given us, though we are unworthy. Do not shame us because of our sins, but help and save us, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lord Jesus, stretch forth your right hand and bless your people. Protect them by your holy cross. Be their shelter and refuge, and perfect them with your abundant blessings, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your blessed Father, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
I want to take this time to thank the choir for the beautiful work you do, and also for the fact that you've given up extra time to prepare for next week's Passion Week. So thank you for the extra. Some of them have been snowed out. Thank you for your devotion. I think everyone will recognize the act and the time and the energy and the love that you put into it. So thank you, and may God bless you in your work, the possible. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.